There's a ghost town in northern Mexico filled with ruined stone buildings and long abandoned silver mines that hint at the town's lucrative past. The only functional structure left is a huge suspension bridge called the Puente de Ojuela, which spans a deep valley to the south of the town. The 300 meter long bridge was built by the same people that built the Brooklyn Bridge, and when it went up, the Puente de Ojuela was the third longest suspension bridge in the world. Now though, the area is experiencing something of a renaissance. Thanks to a quirk of geology and a little bit of luck, there's something pretty and valuable in those mines once again. Today, Ojuela, in the rural state of Durango in northern Mexico, is a ghost town populated only by occasional tourists. Like many of the ghost towns that dot the US and Mexico, its success relied on the extraction of precious metals beneath the surface. Spanish prospectors discovered silver and gold here way back in 1598, and Ojuela thrived mostly on the profits from the silver mines for around 350 years. The town became an important point on the UNESCO-recognized El Camino Real de Tierra Adentro, otherwise known as the Silver Route. That route was used for transporting and trading silver through Mexico and the United States. And this old trade route was only made possible by even older geological events. The gold and silver bearing rocks here formed when hot hydrothermal fluids from underlying magma pushed up through the Cretaceous Age limestone that makes up Ojuela's hillsides. These fluids carry all kinds of rare elements within them, which are deposited when the liquid cools and crystallizes. The result is what's known as a polymetallic hydrothermal ore deposit, where the good stuff is concentrated in veins that crisscross through the main rock body. And Ojuela's metal deposits were huge. Over the years, the mines have yielded about 2.5 million kilograms of silver, 17,000 kilos of gold, and 816,466 metric tons of lead. Eventually, though, all of the shiny stuff was mined out, leaving nothing to support the historic mining town. Without its subterranean source of wealth, Ojuela was abandoned and left to fall into ruin. But this was far from the end of Ojuela's story, because these mines were also hiding a secret stash of other, much more unexpected minerals. Most of the minerals we encounter in the world of geology formed in one of two ways. Some crystallize out from a primary liquid. For instance, the olivine and feldspar that make up igneous rocks forms when hot magma or lava cooled, and the calcite that glues together sedimentary rock crystallized out of supersaturated water. Others are forged under high temperatures and pressures without melting. That's how some metamorphic minerals like kyanite and garnet form. But there's a whole other class of so-called secondary minerals that are only made when pre-existing rocks are altered at the Earth's surface. Essentially, what's going on here is weathering, a process we more often associate with breaking things down than making anything new. But weathering exposes rocks to water and oxygen, which they likely won't have seen while they were forming inside the crust. The minerals in these rocks are what's known as metastable, meaning that they're fine to hang out in the high pressure conditions underground, but aren't built to withstand the environment up on the surface. It doesn't take a lot of heat or pressure to alter them either. Just a subtle shift is enough to get the change going. Sometimes, the secondary minerals form because elements in that primary material dissolve away, while the insoluble ones stick around. Water, oxygen, and other compounds combine with what's left behind to create a new mineral with a brand new chemical formula. All of this takes place gradually and at temperatures well below the mineral's melting point. And some of these secondary minerals have come to be incredibly useful to us over the years. For instance, weathering of feldspar can produce kaolinite, which is a type of clay used in pretty much all pottery and ceramics. Feldspars can also weather into something called gibbsite, which is one of the main sources we use to extract aluminum. Sometimes though, chance chemical alteration can conspire to create minerals that aren't necessarily useful, but they are beautiful. And at the Ojuela mine, gem collectors stumbled across some of these secondary riches in 1946, when they dug into a grotto filled with lime green bubbles bubble-shaped crystals of adamite. Remember that the town's gold and silver were originally part of a polymetallic ore deposit, meaning that there were several different kinds of metal in the hydrothermal veins. Previously, only the shiny precious metals had been considered valuable enough to be worth mining, but years of weathering made a less valuable metal into jaw-dropping crystals, zinc. Zinc and arsenic happened to be big components of this particular hydrothermal system, and so the rocks altered to make a unique collection of zinc and arsenic-rich minerals, including this adamite. Adamite is a zinc arsenate hydroxide, and the crystals can be a range of colors depending on the other elements that find their way into the mineral structure. They'll be clear or white if they're very pure, yellow if they have iron, lime green with copper, and occasionally pink with cobalt or purple with manganese. Some crystals even glow yellow or green under UV light thanks to a small amount of uranium-bearing ions within them. Naturally, the crystals grow in an elongated shape, but because their growth depends on the space they have available and the flow of water around them, they can create some interesting formations and complex clusters called druses. They can even grow on other secondary minerals like limonite, like these ones did. After the 1946 discovery of adamite in Ojuela's mines, gem collectors realized what a treasure trove this secondary ore deposit was. Exploration over the following decades revealed more than 100 other brightly colored secondary minerals scattered throughout the veins. In the mid-20th century, miners realized they could earn more from these colorful gems than they could from the gold and silver left in the mines. So Ojuela is experiencing a second life thanks to its secondary minerals. It might not be enough to rebuild a whole town, but it's enough to keep Ojuela on the map. And this month, SciShow Rocks Box subscribers can get a piece of Ojuela in their mailbox. This month's specimens are adamite crystals on limonite, plucked out of the mines just for you. Our Rocks Box minerals are always ethically sourced and carefully chosen to bring you a high quality geological specimen. If you aren't a subscriber, head over to scishow.rocks to sign up for our waitlist and check out some of our other rock hound gear for sale, like this geologist loop, which even has our SciShow logo on it. Thanks for watching.